I want to talk to you a little bit about the Amira camera, give you a general introduction, tell you what's new in terms of our software update packages that we have delivered and will be delivering. Give you a little sneak preview of a new nice feature, UHD recording that we've now implemented in first prototypes. And at the end of the session, I will start with a look workflow demo, so you can actually see how we can shoot some footage, prepare a look inside the computer, upload it back into the camera, and use it in the editing program. Just a full workflow. So whenever, you know, if you think you don't need the look part, then basically after, I'd say, probably the first hour or so, we're just going to cover that. If you want to stick around for the hands-on, you're very welcome to do so. Okay. So, can we maybe dim the lights? I have to dim the lights. Danke. Ja, ganz aus, oder? Maybe a little bit brighter. Now you can see anything. You can see something. Let's take a brighter screen. So our Amira camera is a very versatile tool. It's been adopted already in a number of TV series, documentary productions, industrial film, corporate films. And all this is thanks to, of course, this is not shot on the Amira. All this is thanks to her big sister, the Alexa. The Amira uses the same sensor that we built into our Alexa cameras. It's called the Aleph 3 sensor, which has a very magnificent latitude of 14 and a little bit over 14 stops. It delivers very nice skin tones, has very good color reproduction in general, a very subtle highlight handling. So when you get very strong highlights in your image, you have a very soft roll off. So most DPs actually love the Amira for that very feeling that it gives you. Yeah, and as I said, it has in general a very good color rendition. So that's why the camera is visually very appealing. In terms of handling, the camera is built to be to have the best possible single user ergonomics. So the menu and everything moved to the left side, to the operator side. We integrated a shoulder arc into the camera, which, depending on the lens, you can move the camera forward and backward, so you can slide it to be more comfortable resting on your shoulder, so it's not very front heavy. A lot of the very light and very small cameras these days have the problem that you always have to carry them with a rig, and you have a shoulder rest and two arms, and then the camera is basically set on the very front. And unless you put the batteries all the way back behind your shoulders, you always have to carry it on your arms. With this camera, it's more like a camcorder feeling. So most people who've seen it and tested it so far always think it's, you know, it's very comparable to an old Beta camcorder, essentially. That's the feel you have when you have it on the shoulder. So there we used the camera for some track testing earlier this year. Also, of course, very useful is our viewfinder with a fold-out monitor. So we have a monitor that you can fold out and flip around. So you can use it as a finder or to control the menus of the camera. And the audio controls are placed on the opposite side. So once you have your mics connected, you don't have to be fiddling with your inputs anymore, then these are out of your way, so you have less clutter on the operator side. The camera offers cost-efficient in-camera grading, so we have the possibilities to, depending on the model that you buy, just alter a little bit the tonal balance, so you can make the image more contrasty or less contrasty, tint it in a little bit in a way. Or with the advanced license, you can actually have full look controls. So just like an onset colorist or with primary color correction, you can adjust the colors in your image. And in the highest possible version, the premium Amira, you have the option to even import a 3D lookup table that a colorist graded for you in a standard grading system like Resolve or Filmlight, something like that. So you can create different looks and use them directly in the camera, record with these looks, preview them on set, and the look data is always embedded in your metadata. The whole look workflow I'll explain later on. So all in all, the Amira is a safe and future-proof investment. We put the camera and electronics into a very rugged housing, so just like the Alexa, it's an aluminum body. That means it's very sturdy. If the camera bumps or knocks against the door or something, you don't have to worry about anything. It won't break any of the electronics inside. Also, it uses a very fairly unique and new cooling system. You can compare it to the new Mac Pro. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Essentially, there's a tunnel inside the camera, and the camera sucks in air on the sides and the front, pulls the air through the tunnels and blows it out through the back. And all the electronics are placed on the outside walls of the tunnel. So through the inside, you have your air going through, and if there's dust or wet air, humid air, it all goes through the inside of the tunnel that cools the whole housing, but the electronics are completely sealed from the outside. It's not a waterproof camera, but it's very good in difficult environmental situations. Like the Alexa, we created a camera based on FPGAs. FPGAs essentially means the boards inside the cameras. They can be reprogrammed, rerouted to give you new exciting features. On the Alexa, that's the best proof for how extensible such a system can be. We are now into SUP 10, that's been shipped or going to ship very soon, I think next week. But now we are in the second beta of that. And with every SUP, to be fair, the first one was, I think, 3.0, so the first two were kind of internal. But all the SUPs always broadened the functions that you had in the camera. We integrated S-by-S recording, high-speed ARRI RAW recording, the new SIM2 recording module with the different recording modules, so now you can store to S-by-S capture drives and C-fast cards that are also used in the Amira camera. So it's a very... it's not the cheapest way to build a camera with FPGAs, but it's a very, very good technology because it's very expandable. So what's the differentiation? If we already talk about Alexa, what's the differentiation between Alexa and Amira? Often people ask, you know, why should I even buy an Alexa now that the Amira is out? One important difference, of course, is that there's no ARRI RAW recording in an Amira. So ARRI RAW, as you can see in our booth, now has just gotten a little bit bigger with the Alexa 65. So this format is very widely adopted in very renowned post tools. So basically, if you want to build a workflow, it's difficult to find tools that do not support ARRI RAW at this time. So for feature film, definitely ARRI RAW will give you, of course, the best quality there. You don't have 4x3 capture in the camera. It's the same sensor, but we only use a 16x9 area. So you cannot use it with anamorphic lenses. And it's got no integrated plus functions. So you don't have wireless lens control integrated, and you don't have, for example, there's something in the cameras called digital bubble level, so you can have a little Wasserwaage, a little level in the center that will tell you if the camera is properly set with the horizon straight. Now, of course, if you don't have wireless in the camera, my colleague Hendrik Voss always has some smart ideas and builds stuff like this. So this is the EMC. I don't know exactly what it means. I think EB motor controller or something like that. So what this does is it's a very small receiver that can connect to a Cabrio lens or a Canon lens. And with that, you can drive the motors or the servos that are already integrated in the lens. So it gives you a very small and small wireless setup for the camera. So of course, there are ways around, but it's not integrated. You have to add boxes. So that's the difference. Okay. Now, looking back to what we've delivered so far, right now we are at SUP 1.0.11 or 1.5. It depends a little bit when your camera was built. 1.5 is, I believe, is the current one that the current release that you download on the internet. So between the initial introduction of the cameras and now, we have implemented some changes to the audio recording. So right now we are limiting the input to minus 6 dB. So when you feed in an audio signal that's too high, we limit it on the input side. We have a bad block recovery. We found that some of the CFast cards, even though we tested very thoroughly and we have very strict tests for the CFast cards, some of them might, in really bad circumstances, create bad blocks. So that's a physical bad block on the storage media, meaning a clip cannot be accessed anymore. You have to send it to service and we have to recover it. Now, that doesn't happen, that's not the usual case. That would happen if you, for example, in the middle of the shot, pull the battery from the camera. That's when this can occur. With 1.015 or 1.1, we now have a bad block recovery automated in the camera, meaning the camera will recover the files and tell you that there has been a problem. Please remove the card, copy the files over, format the card, reuse the card. So the clips are fully intact now and it's completely automated inside the camera. We had some improvements to the playback mode. So you now you can use faster forward scan speeds. And for example, you can tell the camera to playback the entire card. So before it was just clip by clip or loop after each clip. And now you can playback the entire card back to back. So you can, if you want to watch dailies essentially from the camera, you can do it that way. Right, the whole graphical user interface has been reworked. So we now have a much simplified alert state management. So you can see just a little exclamation mark. If you press it, you get everything. And also the system info has been gathered into one screen. So just a little bit of cleaning done. All right, now we started the beta for SUP 1.1 and we're very close to releasing it. With beta 1.1, we will have Bluetooth audio monitoring and recording. So the camera, as you may know, can record 4 tracks with digital input, digital audio inputs. No. Let me start again. It can record 4 tracks, 4 digital tracks, and it has for that some mono stereo inputs, analog, and 2 digital inputs. We also have a 5th track that's a Bluetooth audio track that can be recorded with a simple headset. The Bluetooth connection can also be used for monitoring, so and that's now been added to the camera. So you can listen to the sound that you've recorded, or if you're recording any sound. Often, if you're an operator who has the camera on the shoulder and needs to take it down for some shots and then back up, if you have a headset with a cable dangling off your ear, then you generally pull it out. And so for them, it's better to use a Bluetooth headset. We have a dynamic auto-tracking white balance in the camera. If you turn that on, it's like a little home camcorder and you walk outdoors to indoors and it'll change the color temperature for the shot. So can be useful, might not be useful depending on what you do. We have a Wi-Fi remote in the camera now, so we can try that later on. The camera essentially has a Wi-Fi access point built in. I can connect from my laptop, connect to the camera network, open the web page, and then I have the full camera menu accessible on my computer, on my iPhone, anything that has a web browser. Can be a Samsung Galaxy, doesn't have to be an Apple. So I can remotely access that menu. That also, of course, works with a cable connection. So if I have the camera on a crane and I'm running cables up there anyway, I can use a cable connection, have a much more stable connection to the camera than wirelessly. Also, some sets, they don't allow you to use Wi-Fi. So for them, of course, a cable connection is better. Then we introduced, finally, the weekly licensing, meaning you can, on a weekly license, get an update from a basic camera to an advanced or a premium camera. So you can add features, you know, if you buy a camera and you don't want to spend all that money for the premium, Then you can also buy a basic package, and then if you have a customer who needs 200 frames per second log C recording, then you can just buy the premium package for 1 or 2 weeks and don't have to spend all the money. And then there's a new feature, it's called pre-recording function. We already had that in the Alexa. You can set the camera to pre-record mode, and then it will internally run up to 20 seconds. It depends a little bit on the frame rates, but in 24, 25, it's up to 20 seconds of pre-roll. So the camera keeps loop recording, and then when you press the record key, then the last 20 seconds are already in the clip, and you start from there. So it's very useful when you have to work with children or with animals, where you never know when the action starts, or in sports, for example. So that's, of course, not everything. We also had some user requests that we fulfilled. One of them was a faster boot up time. We are now below 15 seconds with the camera. There's a waveform monitor in the viewfinder screen, or in the, if this camera had been updated, it would have a viewfinder screen. There's a waveform monitor available. We have color bar display. If you have an ENG lens on the camera, you can start stop recording with the record button on the back. The return button can serve as a user button, so you can assign it to zoom in, for example, if you want to have focus. We have Genlock now enabled in the camera, so you can synchronize several cameras to each other if you're in a kind of a studio setup. The audio channels have been decoupled. Before, we had one limitation, is that the audio inputs on A, so A was 1 and 2, because A is a stereo input in the camera. B and C, which are two mono inputs, they were always ganged. So you could only control the gain if you had auto gain or gain with limiter turned on. Then you would control B and C simultaneously. So we had that decoupled now. Like I said, UI messaging has been simplified a little bit. And then there's something, playback button delay. I don't know how to properly call that in English. There's a little play button on the bottom of the viewfinder. And if you accidentally touch it very briefly, then the camera would go into play screen. So, you know, people were a little bit annoyed with that. Now we changed that behavior, so you actually have to hold down the button for a second or two before it goes into the play screen. Little enhancements, of course, no. Technically, we changed a little bit also the HDSDI outputs. Before, we only had a clean output, so you could not see menu entries, frame lines, or anything. So that's now configurable. We have a user interface for the EF mount. The EF mount for Canon lenses is now in prototype stage. It should be available as, I don't know, prototype is available now, I think. And I don't know when the product will be available. I believe next year, early next year. So there's a user interface in the camera. You can use the menu wheel to open or close the iris, and you can assign a user button to open or close the iris. You can go from, I think, an eighth of a stop up to one full stop with one press of a button. The camera includes a new and improved debayering algorithm. So that's also in the Alexa now. It's the ADA5, which gives you a better image quality. There are many small UI and menu improvements. Some bug fixes: if you use a hand grip on the camera and you have the little green button, the RS button, then I think after rebooting the camera, you needed to press it twice for the camera to start. So little bugs like that have been removed. Right, if you shot interlaced, the camera would show you only half the remaining recording time. So there was a calculation bug in there. If you use a lens that flips the image upside down, that, like the ultra-wide zoom, we can now rotate the image in the camera. And we embed the full lens data system information. So if you have a camera, a lens like a Cabrio, or the lightweight Allura zooms, or the Master Primes, or the LDS Ultra Primes, they will give you information on the setting of your focus, your iris, and if it's a zoom, also on the focal length. That data is now, you can display it on the screen, and you can record it in the metadata automatically. You don't have to do anything, it's just there. Okay, other updates is of course our B4 mount. The camera has a removable lens mount. It's actually very, very easy to detach. You just need an Allen screwdriver and open four screws that are on the front of the camera. So here, 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 here. Then the whole viewfinder comes off. Lens mount comes off. There are no cables to attach or detach. There's a connector plate behind that, so it's really easy to do. You can do it in like 1 minute. Take off the viewfinder, the lens mount, and pop on another one. So even in a production where you'd have maybe EF lenses, let's say you have EF lenses so you can walk in the crowd, and then you have PL lenses for the bigger scenery setups, you can bring these two with you. As long as you use the same PL mount on this on the same body, you don't run into problems with shimming as well. So B4 mount, we created our own B4 mounts. What they do is they scale the image from the lens to the full 35 millimeter size. So as a result, you get the same depth of field that you have on a ENG camcorder. So you have a very long depth of field. And of course, because we're using the same amount of light to illuminate not a very small, but a slightly bigger sensor, you also are losing some stops. I think it's like two stops, a little above two stops of light that you lose by using a B4 mount. In general, everybody likes the results they get with the mount. It's a very good optical image quality. We tested this mount with NFL, and they were quite happy with it. Right, EF mount I just talked about. Also new is the viewfinder optics. You can look at it later. I'm going to leave it out. So in my magic box here, I have a prototype, which looks a little bit like from a Russian submarine, so I'm not going to take it out. But this one, this is the viewfinder prototype with a new optical element in here. It has a much better image circle. So if you move your eye around behind the viewfinder, with the original design, you get slight blurs on the edges. With this design, it's a very, very clear image. It's only about, I don't know, half a centimeter longer than the original one. So this one will be updated, I think, next year. So I have a working prototype here, which we can actually put on the camera later on. New shoulder pad, I don't have that with me. The shoulder pad on the camera is a little bit uncomfortable because it's very, very thin on the sides. So for some people, you've had pressure here and pressure in the back. We now made it much softer and wider. Unfortunately, I don't think we have it at the booth, but we're collecting feedback right now as we're giving it out to sample productions or productions who want to use the camera as a demo. And we changed the audio recording. Before, like I said, we had the limitation of a maximum 8 dB input level for the camera. That works fine with most field mixers, but if you're in a studio mixer environment, I don't know how many of you actually have to deal with sound, but studio levels are usually 24 dBU, so if you feed that signal into the camera, it just records a clipped sound all the time. So because that sometimes can be a problem and you have to work around, it's not so nice, so we changed it. We changed the audio boards to now accept also the higher input levels. Okay, and finally we have UHD support. That's a preview for next year. We can record ProRes up to ProRes 444, so the full quality. Up to 60 frames per second in UHD. You can essentially update a camera just by buying a license. All the cameras that are built right now get a new calibration. So we calibrate a bigger sensor size to be visually accurate, or provide accurate image data. And by adding that license, you can then update the camera and just turn a any Amira, I believe, into a UHD Amira. The camera will also have a new recording mode, ProRes 3.2K, that will also come for the Alexa. And the reason is that in order to create a UHD image, we capture 3200 by 1800. So 3.2K is what we capture in RAW. And then with our new debayering algorithms, we scale up to 3840 by 2160. So it's a slight upscale. And because we're basing everything on 3.2K, that mode is now also available on the Amira and on the Alexa. So if you have a post house and need to work with both cameras in one production, you can just use the same input format, use the same scalers to get the same output. So that's the idea behind it. Okay. Now I talked through the whole thing. I didn't show you the showreel. Maybe we look at that screen for a second. So what I want to show you is some footage that we created with an Alexa. We shot some material in Arri RAW 3.2K to simulate UHD output. So that was the first stage, more like a feasibility test. It's like an architectural video that we shot. Second, we have some UHD footage that I captured with this camera in Zurich at the Athletics Championship. And this gives you a preview of the UHD quality.